Well, good morning. How's everyone doing this morning? Good. I'm glad that you're here this morning on this incredibly wonderful sunny Sunday. And so I trust and pray that once our service is over and you get a chance to head outside, that you'll enjoy the day. And as you're enjoying the day, take a moment every so often to pause and say thank you, God, for a wonderful day. And also, we're going to be celebrating Mother's Day. Are you in for a treat? Have you ever heard of someone try to explain something they've never experienced and never done? So I'm going to talk about Mother's Day from a father's perspective, which means it's going to be very, very, very entertaining. We just ask you to keep an eye out on our announcements, the emails that come out, the connections page, and take a look at all that's going around and happening here at SUMC. We are so blessed to be in a community that wants us to be engaged with them. And so there are opportunity upon opportunity if you want to be engaged in our community. And if so, just contact the office, contact Matt McKelvey or Jim Troutman, our missions chair, co-chairs, and they will make sure that there are plenty of chances for you to select and say, hey, I'd like to be involved in this, or hey, any opportunity we could do something for this, and we'll work every way we can to make sure that we can be engaged in our community and you can feel like you're a part of that. If you'd take one moment and stand up and greet each other in Christian love, and those that are watching via the internet, Facebook Live and Twitter, find somebody in your family and high five and give them a little bit of Christian love this morning.
Can you say amen to that this morning?
Amen. Amen.
Good playing. Thank you so much. Church, stand with us this morning for our gathering as you are able. Our scripture this morning is from Psalm 98, and this is kind of like the modern translation, and it is responsive. Sing to God a new song.
For God has done marvelous things.
Make a joyful noise to God, all the earth.
For God is still doing marvelous things.
Break into joyful song.
Sing praises with the lyre and melody and trumpets.
Plug in the keyboard. Tune up those guitars. Try out the drums. Let the seas roar and the floods clap their hands. Open the windows. Listen to the choirs outdoors, feathered and furred.
Let the hills sing together for joy.
For God is not done doing wonders.
God is coming to set everything right.
Sing a new song to God. Come and sing to God a new song. Remain standing for our song this morning, all creatures of our God and King.
Of our God and King.
seated. And join us in our prayer of confession from John 15, which is responsive, and then join us in our songs after that, which is Change My Heart, O God, and Tell My People. Jesus, you taught us to abide in your generous love.
For it completes our lives and gives us joy.
You ask us to love others as you have loved us,
for it brings your creation to fruition.
We sometimes struggle to love the people in our lives as you have loved us. Forgive us, we pray,
and teach us your love.
Amen.
I actually wrote these words down because I wanted to make sure I got them right. So bear with me. I really understand that that as joyful as this day might be, that it also could contain some sorrow and disappointment. And such is the case for me. I've lost a mother, as some of you have as well. And I think of those women, I think of those women that that would have loved to have been mothers, but have not yet been given the opportunity. And I think of those women who have have lost a child right at the cusp of becoming a mother, losing a child during the birthing process, or even someone who may have aborted a child and continue to live with the pain of wondering what the world might have been if. And yet I'm willing to acknowledge that in the midst of such pain, that each one of us have a mother. And as such, we have much to learn and much to celebrate. And so I started thinking about that. What if, what if, what if, what if? Have you ever had that kind of echo through your mind? And you'll never guess where I went. Jeff Foxworthy. Anybody know what Jeff Foxworthy is known for? Okay, there you got it. So I thought that maybe on this Mother's Day, it might be appropriate for me to say, you might be a mom when. We could get in trouble if I used the word if, copyright and all that. You might be a real mom if or when your heart is so filled with love that it feels like it's going to burst. Or it could be the opposite. You might be a mom if your head is so pounding that it feels like it might explode. Oh, and then I thought about this, because this has been some of our experience. You might be a mom when you don't remember the color of your kitchen floor. You see, it's one of those favorite days when a little hand clutching dandelions is much more precious than the most exquisite flower arrangement. It's the best day that you can possibly think when you remember that this is probably the day that you will not have to gag when you clean up gargantuan messes of bodily fluids on the floor. Or read the same storybook 323 times over and over and over. Or maybe even it might be the most incredible day when going grocery shopping alone with your spouse is counted as a date. Oh, and maybe you soar with pride at something that your child you never thought would do, or also the opposite could be true when your child's behavior makes you shrink with embarrassment, or when you know the meaning of true love, or the opposite, when you experience more pain than you could ever have imagined. So I thought this morning, knowing that I could only go so far with a Jeff Foxworthy type of sermon, because we'd be out way too short, and we cannot have that. You've all paid for the full hour. I started to think about someone else that maybe might help me portray Mother's Day. Anybody remember what Joan Rivers is famous for? Can we talk? She'd sit there and she'd say, now, can we just talk? So can we talk today about Mother's Day? It's one of those days of the year where mothers are not supposed to do dishes. We're supposed to honor them by not having them do dishes. And we honor them by saying, don't have to do the laundry today. No meals to cook. And if you're a mom, you might say, whoa, 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 whoa. That would be wonderful. But I'd rather have a spa day. So can we really talk? Because I don't know what it's like to be a mother. Now, I learned a lot about mothering. I mean, I watched my mother, my late mother, Barbara. I watched Catherine's late mother, June. And I watched Catherine mothering our three children. And it showed me how incredible mothering can be. As those children kind of grow through different stages in their growth process. And some might say, yes, and mothering also includes seeing husbands grow through specific growth processes as well. Watching those kids get older and wiser. I remember when our son Benjamin was born, and I remember that we were scared to death. I mean, we've heard parents say that kids should come with a manual of some kind, and we never was given one at the hospital, and yet we paid $3,000, and that kid wasn't even potty trained. I remember taking this little one home and saying, what do I do if he doesn't burp again? That air would just back up, and would he end up being bloated? And finally, I talked with a dear friend at a church we were attending, Frank and Louise Blevins, who simply said, well, Gordon, Catherine, maybe he doesn't have to burp just now. I remember watching Catherine mothering as we were walking into a Walmart, and there was a couple that was walking out of a Walmart, and the man was extremely overweight. And I remember our son letting loose of Catherine's hand and running up to this man and pointing right at his stomach and saying, Mom, is that fat? And I remember Catherine gently taking his hand and saying, yes, but it doesn't mean that he's not kind. I remember trying to be both father and mother during our seminary years, when on Sunday Catherine was working at the hospital and I would have to dress the children and take them to the church as I was involved in my active pastoral duties. And I thought it was just so kind of those older ladies at the church that as soon as I walked in with these two kids, that they would swoop them up and take them and say, Pastor, we've got them. And when I saw them next, they didn't look like my kids. Who knew that buttons go on the back of a shirt for kids? And who knew that smudge, that dark spot on their chin wasn't a bruise? And who knew that hair could be combed back? Oh, since the birth of our second and third son, a second son and our third daughter, we've become experts. I want you to hear this. It is not, let me back up. I do not do political things. But it sounded funny when I wrote it. That since the birth of our last two children, Joshua and Hannah, Catherine and I have become experts in the equal distribution of wealth. Everybody gets the exact same amount of snacks. Everybody gets the exact same amount of toys. Evenly dispensed. And yet for all my shortcomings as a father, and when Catherine is gone, to sometimes having to be mother in the home, here's some observations that I've learned about what it really means to be a mom. And you probably have heard, because these are not original with me. I would never be able to pick these things up. Because you see, real mothers know that when they cannot find a utensil in the kitchen, to look in the sandbox. Real mothers never want to know what the vacuum cleaner has sucked up. And real mothers really know that a child's growth is not measured in height or years or the grade that they're in school, but it's by the progression of how they address you from mommy to mom to mother. You see, those who have worked through these things in life and have lived them out personally understand that all mothers have mastered what us guys would really like to be able to master, and that is multitasking. Part of a dual income family and yet able to make it to soccer games and Girl Scout meetings. know the importance of teaching the children not only how to count and how to relate to each other and others, but also how to love Jesus Christ. I remember the most from the late two mothers and the mother of my children that I've been blessed with, that scripture reading is an important part of mothering. Even in the playing of games, I remember a neighbor, a friend of ours in seminary. She was actually the wife of one of the professors, and she would invite the children to come over and play Risk with her. And you know what? It wasn't about conquering the world, but it was about saving the world for Christ. What countries can we save next? Putting that missionary emphasis, the love of God for the whole world, into their minds. It's about giving more than you can ever imagine. I read in preparation for this, and I think it's readily available that a teacher asked a boy a question and said, "Now, suppose that your mother baked the pie and there were seven of you and your parents and five children. What percentage of the pie, or what part of the pie would you get?" And the boy said, "I would get a sixth." And the teacher said, "So, no, son, you're not getting this fraction thing." I said, "There's seven of you, and there's a pie, and each of you get a piece of the pie." And the boy said, "Yes, I would get a sixth. You don't know my mother. My mother wouldn't take a piece of pie. She would give it to all of us." Showing again God's love in practical ways. Strictly speaking to the women here today, and guys, we'll get to our part next month. You're part of a community, mothering community. I have seen this everywhere I've gone. Everywhere we've been, every church that we've been blessed to serve in, mothers do not mother alone. It's much in the same way that we as members of a church take our baptismal vows and we become a part of a community. There's a community of motherhood. And in some way, each one here today, much in the way in my early seminary years, that the mothers of the church look and care for those that need that help. So it's a simple, small token that we take a day like today and we say we want to honor those who have not only brought us into the world, but have raised and nurtured us in our early years, and yes, even in some of our waning years. It's a part of our denomination. It's a part of who we have in our DNA. 1914, the Congress passed a law designating the second Sunday in May as Mother's Day. President Woodrow Wilson. So let me close with these few words. Some things to remember about mothers before we venture back out into the real world. Real mothers teach us about foresight, how to look ahead and calculate the what ifs in life. Have you ever heard your mother say, "Make sure you wear clean underwear. You might be in an accident." Remember that? I remember that. They teach us about logic, helping us to look through all the implications of things that could happen and come. Because I've heard my mom say something like, you fall out of that tree and break your neck, don't you come crying to me. You know better than be up in the tree that high. They teach us about maturing and about maturity, because I know that mothers have said, eat your vegetables or you'll never grow up. Oh, they teach us about prayer. I remember, and maybe you have too, you better pray that comes out of those pants. Something that we haven't quite accomplished in our science yet, but they teach us about time travel. My mom never said it to me, but I think a mom probably has said it before for some child that hasn't quite figured out how to act appropriately. If you don't straighten up, a mother would say, I'm going to knock you into the middle of next week. Not that we condone knocking, okay? I'm just saying. They teach us about how we can view things from different perspectives without even knowing that it's possible. Because I remember my mom saying, if you looked in the back of your neck, it's dirty. I didn't know I could turn my head around that far to see it. They teach about perseverance. You're going to sit there at the table until you eat every last piece of that broccoli. Oh, they teach us about genetics. I've heard my mom say, you're just like your dad. They know about the weather as well. Because there's been a time or two that my mom had come into the room and said, now, Gordon, your room looks like a tornado's been through it. Now, let me end with this. You may have encountered this, but mothers do teach us about the circle of life, do they not? I have personally heard my mother say in her exhaustion over something I should not have done, saying, Gordon, I brought you into the world and I can take you out of this world. So there's only one thing left. Let all of us who are and those who have and have had a mother say, amen.
Invitation to the offering. We began our worship today with a psalm about the new songs that God inspires us to sing. In our gospel lesson, we heard Jesus teaching his disciples a new song, a love song about Jesus' love for his disciples and for the world. Jesus hoped we would all join in singing and living out this new song of love. Today, in giving to others, let us join in this song so that the whole world may hear the beautiful and welcoming melody of God's love. Ushers, please come forward.
Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. Heir of salvation, purchased of God, born of his Spirit. This is my story.
These gifts, O God, send them into the world as a sign and song of your joyous work of love. Use them to call and welcome into your house of love all who are your friends and our brothers and sisters. Amen.
Please stand if you are able for the sending, which is from John 15:12, and is responsive, and then join us in our final song, Drenched in Love. Jesus speaks again today.
This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you.
Go in joy and faithfulness, knowing that you, the chosen friends of Jesus, abide in Jesus' love and bear the gift of this love to the world. Amen.
Amen.
White as snow, the
Well, my friends, you've been drenched in God's love today. No doubt you've been drenched in a love that equals that that mothers have for us. So now go in the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ and love each other and love the world in the way that Christ has loved each of us. Go in peace.